Hello, everyone. Welcome back. We are on Lecture 11 in Fundamentals of Inorganic Glasses. That corresponds to Chapter 5 in the textbook. Recall, we're spending a total of 4 lectures on Chapter 5 because Chapter 5 deals with a lot of the basic structures of different glass families, and we're going to be going through borate and borosilicate glasses today. So remember, we first saw borosilicate glasses back in Chapter 1. And borosilicate glasses were initially invented as a means to lower the thermal expansion coefficient of silicate glasses compared to sodalime silicate while still being meltable at reasonable temperatures. And the way this works is that a large portion of the network modifiers, sodium and calcium, they get replaced by boron oxide B2O3, which is a network former rather than a network modifier, but it has a fewer number of bonds. Each boron just has 3 bonds instead of 4 for silica, and each of those bonds is weaker compared to the bonds in silica. And as a result, the borosilicate glass is able to flow more freely compared to just pure silica, but its network is still more rigid compared to sodalime silicate glass. So it's falling somewhere in between fused silica and sodalime silicate in terms of its melting temperature, its thermal expansion coefficient, its chemical corrosion resistance, and so on. Now, the CTE, the coefficient of thermal expansion of borosilicate glasses, can vary depending upon the exact composition, but it's usually somewhere in the range of 30 to 60 times 10 to the minus 7 per degree C. Glasses like Pyrex that are used for laboratory glassware are at the lower end of this. They are closer to 30, and that means that the CTE of borosilicate glasses like Pyrex is about a third of that compared to sodalime silicate, which means that it has 3 times as good thermal shock resistance. So borosilicate glasses are much better than sodalime for thermal shock resistance. They also have a higher resistance to chemical attack, and that's because they have a higher fraction of network formers compared to network modifiers. And for these reasons, borosilicate glasses are the choice for laboratory glassware. In your chemistry lab, your glass beakers and flasks are generally made from borosilicate glass. It's also the glass of choice for most pharmaceutical glassware. Sometimes sodalime silicate is okay, and more recently, some aluminosilicate glasses have also been proposed for pharmaceutical glassware. But at this point in time, borosilicates are still the dominant choice. Borosilicates are also used for glass baking dishes, so they're used in household cookware. But please be careful because sometimes it's actually sodalime silicate that gets sold as glass cookware. But it's kind of marketed under a brand name that would correspond to a borosilicate glassware. So please be careful about that. If you get the older cookware is borosilicate, but as a cost-saving measure, some companies have switched to using sodalime instead, and that does not get you the same level of thermal shock resistance. And borosilicate glasses can also be used for automobile headlamps, which are exposed to large temperature differentials between the inside and the outside. Now, most of the time, B2O3, boric oxide, is incorporated into a silicate glass to make a borosilicate glass. But what I would like to do is actually start with pure borate glasses, build up the structure of borate glasses, and then see how it works when boron gets incorporated into a borosilicate glass. Borate glasses don't have nearly as many applications, or sorry, borate glasses don't have nearly as many applications as borosilicate glasses, and that's because they corrode so quickly when exposed to a humid environment. They're very hygroscopic, meaning that they react quickly with water and degrade rapidly. However, recently, Delbert Day and his company, Mosai, have developed borate glass fibers that have been used for soft tissue repair, for example, in diabetic patients who have deep ulcers that don't heal on their own. These borate glass fibers can be stuffed into the wound, and their fibrous microstructure provides a natural pathway to stimulate the body's healing process. And the glass is meant to dissolve on a time scale of a few days. As it dissolves, it delivers the chemicals that the body needs to heal itself. And the borate component is actually antimicrobial, so it helps to prevent infections. So borate glasses, while they have not traditionally been used for any applications, have found a really nice application here in the healthcare sector. So let's start off with pure B2O3, pure borate glass. The basic structural unit of pure borate glass is the BO3 triangle. So the boron cation here, this has a 3+ charge. This is bonded to three oxygens. Each of the oxygens have a -2 charge, and so they are bonded to two different units. Does this satisfy Zachariasen's rules? You'll see that it does, because the oxygen coordination around the cation is small. It's three or four. And in this case, for boron, it's three. The cation coordination around the oxygen is two, because each of these oxygens is bonded to two borons. We've got three corners of the structural unit that is shared. So these are forming triangular units, and all three of those corners are shared, and they're shared in a corner-sharing fashion rather than an edge-sharing or face-sharing fashion. So indeed, borate glass does obey Zachariasen's rules, which means that it is a good glass former. Now, the basic structural unit is this BO3 triangle. However, in practice, a large fraction, say 60 to 70%, of those BO3 triangles are actually configured in these three-member boroxyl rings. So if you take three of these triangular units and put them in this corner-sharing configuration, you could put three of these units together, and it forms this three-membered ring. So there's three borons and three oxygens in this ring, and this is called a boroxyl ring. And it's been shown that about two-thirds or so of the borons or of these triangles are a part of boroxyl rings. And so the B2O3 glass has its short-range structure defined by the BO3 triangle. It has an intermediate-range structural feature that's defined by the boroxyl ring, and then it has no long-range order because of the random way in which the boroxyl rings are connected to each other and connected to the BO3 triangles. Now, the interesting thing with borate glasses is that when modifiers like, say, sodium oxide or any other alkali oxide or alkaline earth oxide, when these modifiers are added to B2O3 glass, the modifier can take on two different structural roles. And those two different structural roles can change the properties of the glass in opposite directions. Now, when the modifiers are first added to borate glasses, it takes the structural motif shown at the bottom here, where if you've got this BO3 triangle and you just add a modifier unit to that, much like it does in the case of alumina, the boron here is 3+, just like the alumina is a 3+ charge. The modifier brings an additional 1+ charge, and that creates an effective 4+ charge, where the boron can actually change coordination from threefold coordination to fourfold coordination, because the boron combined with a modifier acts as an effective 4+ charge. And this then enables an additional bridging oxygen. So if we use this language of Q or Q speciation, on the left-hand side, this is a Q3 unit because there are three bridging oxygens. And this gets converted to a Q4 unit because now there are four bridging oxygens. So this actually increases the connectivity of the glass network. Because there are more bonds, that means that the viscosity of the glass goes up. And that means that our melting temperature is going to go up as well. Now, this happens up until a certain point. When enough modifiers are added, this is specifically after about a third of the concentration of the glass's modifiers, then a different structural motif comes into play, where the alkali ions or the modifier ions start to form non-bridging oxygens. So in this case, the BO3 unit reacts with this modifier unit, and actually one of the bridging oxygens converts into a non-bridging oxygen. This is exactly the same as what happens in the silicate case, where the modifier comes in and it breaks one of the bridging oxygen bonds and it forms a weaker ionic bond. Now, when this happens, the connectivity of the glass network goes down because in this case, the Q3 unit is being converted into a Q2 unit. So we start off with the same thing, right? We're starting off with Q3 units of boron reacting with modifiers, but depending upon what else is there in the glass structure, opposite effects can happen. Either the Q3 unit can be converted to a Q4 unit, increasing the connectivity of the network, or the Q3 unit can react with that same alkali oxide and decrease the connectivity of the network by going to a Q2. And this is an effect called the boron anomaly. And what this means is that as modifiers are added to borate glasses, the properties don't all change in one direction. The properties will change initially in one direction as the connectivity of the glass network increases. And then the properties will go through a maximum or minimum and then change in the opposite direction as non-bridging oxygens start to form. You can see this, for example, with the viscosity curve of these glasses. The viscosity increases as modifiers are added up to the point where the fraction of fourfold coordinated boron is maximized. After that point, then Q2 species start to form and the viscosity goes back down. So borate glasses are very interesting from a scientific point of view because of this boron anomaly. And that also makes them technologically quite interesting because it gives us additional ways to tune the properties of the glass by changing the coordination of boron in either borate glasses or more often in borosilicate glasses. Now, with respect to the formation of these BO4 tetrahedra, in this case, each of either the alkali oxide, the M2O, or the alkaline earth oxide, RO, each one of these formula units here is contributing plus two charge of the modifiers. You either have two of the alkali ions, each giving plus one charge, or one of the divalent alkaline earth ions that has a plus two charge. And because each of these units is giving a plus two charge, each of those units creates one pair of tetrahedra. So it's not just converting one boron triangle to a tetrahedron, it's converting two of them into two tetrahedra. So the modifiers are used to convert boron to tetrahedral configuration. And these tetrahedra are not available for creating non-bridging oxygen. So basically it's consuming modifiers by converting the boron from threefold to fourfold coordination, and it's doing so without creating non-bridging oxygens. So here we've got two of these triangular units reacting with, in this case, one formula unit of potassium oxide, and that's creating a pair of borate tetrahedra. And the potassiums are just somewhere nearby in order to charge compensate those tetrahedra. Now, there have been many papers to propose different structural laws that govern the transition from threefold to fourfold coordinated boron, governing this boron anomaly process. One of the most successful is due to Prabhat Gupta, and this is called the random pair model. And Gupta's random pair model has three rules for network formation. First rule is that these BO4 tetrahedra occur in corner sharing pairs. So it's not just one tetrahedron that's sitting isolated from other tetrahedra. They are occurring in pairs together, and those pairs are connected by a bridging oxygen, as shown in this figure here. Second rule is that the pairs of BO4 tetrahedra cannot be bound to each other, meaning that if you've got a pair of these tetrahedra, considering the pair, these pairs of tetrahedra have six oxygens that are available for bridging to additional units outside of those tetrahedra. According to Gupta's random pair model, it's energetically unfavorable for these pairs of tetrahedra to be bonded to other pairs of tetrahedra, it's more energetically favorable for them to be bonded to the BO3 units. And so each of these six oxygens that are available for bonding to other units from this pair of tetrahedra, they need to get bonded to triangular units. And if you consider that each one of these triangular units has 1, 2, 3 oxygens available for bonding, that means that if you take two of these triangular units, there would be 6 oxygens available for bonding, which is exactly the number of bonds that we would that the tetrahedron would have available. And what this means is that the concentration of tetrahedra maxes out at 50%, because at 50% tetrahedral population, that means 50% of the boron is in a fourfold coordination, 50% of the boron is in a threefold coordination, and that means that the number of oxygens that are available for bonding is identical from both the threefold coordinated boron and the fourfold coordinated boron, because the pair of triangles give you 6 bonds available for the oxygens, and the pair of tetrahedra also give you 6 oxygens that are available because of this bridging oxygen that is required to bond the two tetrahedra together. And if you were to try to put more tetrahedra into the glass structure, there wouldn't be enough triangles for them to bond to at that point. And that is what gives us then this maximum in the tetrahedral units. So you can see in this plot here, this shows the fraction of boron species. This is expressed in terms of the QN speciation, and this is expressed as a function of the mole fraction of modifier oxides. In this case, this is the mole fraction of alkali oxides. So at 0, this would be a pure B2O3 glass. For pure B2O3, all of the boron is in the Q3 configuration, and so 100% of the boron is threefold coordinated. As the modifiers are added, there is a loss of Q3 in favor of Q4. So we have pairs of triangles that are being converted to pairs of tetrahedra. The pairs of tetrahedra are bonded to triangular units. And as we add more and more modifiers, there's a greater amount of conversion from threefold coordinated boron to fourfold coordinated boron until we get to this point of having X equals 1/3. Where X equals 1/3, that's where exactly half of the borons are in a fourfold coordinated state, and half of them are in a threefold coordinated state. If we were to add any more fourfold coordinated borons, there wouldn't be enough threefold coordinated borons to bond to them. So this point right here is the maximum, and this represents the crossover point to where non-bridging oxygens start to form. So any modifiers that are added beyond X equals 1/3 then creates non-bridging oxygens. And according to the third rule of Gupta's random pair model, those non-bridging oxygens occur only in the BO3 groups, not in the BO4 groups, which means that beyond this point, there's a conversion of Q3 now to Q2. This decreases the conductivity of the network because non-bridging oxygens are forming. And when non-bridging oxygens form, that means there are fewer bridging oxygens available to bond to the tetrahedral unit. So a byproduct of the conversion of Q3 to Q2 is that we cannot accommodate as much Q4 species because there aren't enough bonds to the trigonal boron that are remaining. And so the maximum amount of Q4 decreases at that point. So there's a loss of Q4 as non-bridging oxygens form. That Q4 converts into Q3, but part of the Q3 is converting to Q2. So beyond X equals 1/3, there's a rather dramatic downshift in the QN speciation because of the formation of non-bridging oxygens and the inability to accommodate as much Q4 units in the network. Now, that is an overview of borate glass structure. Most of the time, B2O3 is not used on its own, but it is incorporated into a silicate glass matrix. And when that happens, we get a borosilicate glass. With a borosilicate glass, there are two network formers. The primary one is silica, SiO2, and then we typically have a lower concentration of B2O3. And now when modifiers are added to a borosilicate glass, the question is, what do they do? Do they form non-bridging oxygens? They could form non-bridging oxygens on the silica units. They could form non-bridging oxygens on the trigonal borate units. Or do they convert boron from a trigonal to a tetrahedral configuration? And so if you've got certain fractions of B2O3 and SiO2 and start adding modifiers to the glass, the question becomes what fraction of those modifiers associate themselves with boron versus associating themselves with silica. And there is some competition then for these modifiers. And this competition is a function of the chemistry of the glass and its thermal history. And this combination of the glass chemistry and thermal history will determine what concentration of those modifiers creates non-bridging oxygens on the silica versus, say, converting boron from 3 to 4-fold coordination. This shows some experimental results. This shows N4, which is the fraction of boron in a tetrahedral configuration. And this is as a function of this ratio R, which is the ratio of the modifier oxide over B2O3. So this modifier in this case is sodium oxide over B2O3. So R equals 0 would mean that there are 0 modifiers. And as R is increasing, the amount of modifiers is decreasing for a given content of B2O3. There's one other ratio here which is important, and that is this K ratio. The K ratio is a ratio between SiO2 and B2O3. And so a higher value of K indicates that a greater fraction of the glass network is silicate. A lower value of K means that a greater fraction of the glass network is B2O3. In fact, a K equals 0 would be a pure borate glass. And for the pure borate glass, you can see that as the modifier is added, so we start off here with 0 fraction of tetrahedral boron. As modifiers are added, it converts boron from trigonal to tetrahedral configuration. That maxes out at a 50% concentration of tetrahedral boron, so this maxes out at N4 equals 0.5. And then beyond that, non-bridging oxygens form and the fraction of tetrahedral boron decreases. So that is the line going down here for K equals 0. Now what we see is that as K increases, meaning as more and more of the glass becomes silica, that this maximum value of N4 is pushed higher and higher. So if we start adding silica to the network, where now the concentration of silica is half the concentration of B2O3, now we can get up to about 55% N4. When this is pushed up to having the same amount of silica and B2O3, then this maximum amount of N4 is almost 60%, and so on. The more silica we add, this allows us to push up the maximum amount of tetrahedral boron higher and higher. And the reason for this is that the boron tetrahedra must occur in pairs, and those pairs of tetrahedra cannot be bonded to each other. In a pure borate glass, that means they have to be bonded to the trigonal borate units. But in a borosilicate glass, they could be bonded to either the trigonal borate units or to silica tetrahedra. And so it's energetically acceptable for the pair of borate tetrahedra to bond to silicate tetrahedra. And therefore, if we increase the population of silica tetrahedra in the network, there's more opportunities for the borate tetrahedra to bond to silicate tetrahedra, meaning that it doesn't require as many of the borate trigonal units. And as a result, that pushes up the maximum amount of N4 that we get. Now, last time we covered not just silicate glasses, but aluminosilicate glasses. And one of the most intriguing families of glasses, and where I spent a large fraction of my career, is in borosilicate glasses. Borosilicate glasses are used for essentially all of the flat panel displays that are in computer monitors, laptop monitors, and many of the smartphone monitors. They are also used as the basis for a lot of the modern cover glasses like Gorilla Glass. And this becomes especially interesting because now there are three different network formers in a borosilicate glass. There is silica, SiO2, there's boron oxide, B2O3, and there's alumina, Al2O3. And now when we start adding modifiers to the glass, now there are three different network formers that those modifiers could associate with. They could associate themselves with alumina, and in fact, that is what is most energetically favorable to happen. When that happens, the modifiers will stabilize alumina in a tetrahedral configuration. The next most energetically favorable thing to happen is actually conversion of boron from trigonal to tetrahedral configuration. So if the modifiers associate themselves with boron, then they can convert from threefold to fourfold coordination, increasing the connectivity of the network. Or the modifiers could associate themselves with silica, in which case they would create non-bridging oxygen, which lowers the connectivity of the network. So if you've got certain fractions of B2O3, Al2O3, and SiO2, and start adding modifiers, there's different probabilities of these modifiers being associated with each of these three different network formers and playing three different structural roles in the glass, and therefore having three different effects on the properties of the glass. And again, this speciation, meaning the mole fraction of the modifiers associated with each of those oxides, each of those network-forming oxides, depends on the chemistry of the glass and also on its thermal history. And this is actually key to the behavior of Gorilla Glass, starting with Gorilla Glass 3, which was a borosilicate glass that introduced this property that was commercialized as native damage resistance. And being able to control the structural properties of the glass, so how much of the modifiers go to boron versus alumina versus silica, was actually the key thing to enable the behavior that we want to see in our chemically strengthened cover glass. Now, we can think about this in terms of an analogy. Let's suppose that you have some big bowl, and the bowl is filled with different marbles. And those marbles have three different colors, red, white, and blue. And those three different colors correspond to the three different network-forming species in the glass. So let's suppose that red corresponds to aluminum, white corresponds to boron, and blue corresponds to silicon. Now, every time that you add one modifier to the glass, that modifier needs to decide where to go. Does the modifier associate itself with aluminum and charge stabilize aluminum in a tetrahedral configuration? Does the modifier associate itself with boron and convert boron from trigonal to tetrahedral coordination? Or does the modifier associate itself with silicon and create a non-bridging oxygen? Now, if the energetics were all the same, this would be the equivalent of just putting a blindfold on and randomly drawing a marble out of this bowl, where the number of different colored marbles reflects the molar concentration of each of your species. So a higher molar concentration means that you've got a greater number of marbles for that species. And typically, the silica would be the dominant species in terms of the mole concentration. So most of the network formers would be silica. Then there would be some certain fraction of alumina, and then some certain fraction of boron. And the number of different colored marbles would reflect those different mole fractions. So if you put your blindfold on and draw out one of those marbles randomly, the probability of getting, say, a blue silicon ion would be equivalent to the mole fraction of silicon ions in that glass. Likewise, the probability of drawing an aluminum or drawing a boron would be scaled with their molar concentrations as well. Now, the reality is that there's different energetics that are associated with this pairing between network formers and network modifiers. And in fact, alumina is very unstable without modifiers. And so the most energetically preferable location for modifiers to go, at least initially, is to associate themselves first with alumina. And this is kind of equivalent in our marble analogy for these aluminum, these red marbles of aluminum, to be much larger compared to the other marbles. The larger the size of the marble means that you're more likely to draw it out of the bowl. And this corresponds to a lower energy. So this is more energetically favorable from a thermodynamic point of view. Boron falls somewhere in the middle, so it's an intermediate sized marble with a medium level of energy. And then silicon is the least energetically favorable. So it's least energetically favorable for the modifier to form a non-bridging oxygen. That being said, the number of silicon atoms is usually the largest because the glass network is usually mostly silica, which means that even though these marbles for silica are the smallest, there's a greater population of them. So from an entropic point of view, silica is favored, but from an enthalpic or an energetic point of view, aluminum is favored, and then boron falls somewhere in between. And then every time that you add a modifier, you're drawing one of these marbles from the bowl. Drawing the marble is like forming a bond between that modifier and that particular network forming unit. And you keep drawing marbles randomly from the bowl without replacement in order to determine all of the interactions between network modifiers and network former species. Now, the statistics of how we do this, if we want to actually calculate what is the probability of a modifier ion associating with a network former, this can be calculated with statistical mechanics. And the probability then on our ith draw, so after having omega number of draws, what is the probability of a particular modifier associating with a particular network former? This is equal to 1 over the partition function, 1 over Q, where this partition function is just normalizing the probability, so they add up to 1. And then there's two factors governing the probabilities. There is the entropic factor, and this is telling us how many of the network forming species are available. So this GI is what's called the degeneracy of the network forming species. This is just a count of how many of them are there, minus how many of those species have already formed bonds with modifiers already. So we need to take the total number of that particular type of network forming species, subtract the ones that have already formed bonds because they're no longer available for bonding again. And this gives us the entropic contribution, which is just based on the number of marbles, so the number of species there. This is multiplied by a Boltzmann probability factor, which gives us our enthalpic contribution. So if we've got different enthalpies that are associated with the bonds between the network modifiers and network formers, if those enthalpies are given by H sub I, then the Boltzmann probability factor accounting for those enthalpies is e to the minus enthalpy over Boltzmann's constant K times the temperature at which the structure of the glass becomes frozen, which we can approximate by the fictive temperature. And so when I said earlier that the speciation of the network modifiers in terms of what are the concentrations of network modifiers associating themselves with different network formers, that speciation depends on both the composition of the glass as well as the thermal history. The composition comes into play through this entropic contribution based on the number of species. So if you've got a greater mole fraction of silica, for example, that gives you a greater entropic driving force for choosing silica. However, The thermal history also comes into play based on the energetics of bonding and which association between a modifier and a network former is more energetically or more enthalpically favored. And that enthalpy or energy is compared to the available thermal energy where the structure of the glass becomes frozen in. And this gives us the fictive temperature component via TF. So if you cool the glass faster, you're freezing in a higher fictive temperature. And a higher fictive temperature here means that the structure of the glass is going to favor entropy. However, if you cool the glass more slowly, that gives you a lower fictive temperature. And a lower fictive temperature means that you will favor a glass structure with a lower entropy. And so that is all given here by this equation, which shows you the trade-off between the entropic contribution governed by chemistry and the enthalpic contribution, which is governed by bonding energetics and thermal history. So how do we use this? We can use this to help tailor design the boron concentration in borosilicate glasses. For example, on the left here, this shows nuclear magnetic resonance results, NMR results, which can measure how much of the boron is in a threefold versus a fourfold coordination state. And we can adjust that by changing the chemistry of the glass. So this is by changing the mole fractions of modifier oxides, alumina, boron oxide, and silica, and by changing the thermal history of the glass. And the idea here with this equation is that this N4 is given by your number of modifiers minus the alumina, because the modifiers will first want to charge compensate alumina. So all of the alumina need to be charge compensated first. Whatever modifiers are left over after compensating alumina, that's this numerator here, they get distributed between converting boron from three to fourfold coordination and creating non-bridging oxygens on silica, where this delta H is the enthalpy difference between forming a non-bridging oxygen versus converting boron from threefold to fourfold coordination. And so if we've got this delta H here, this delta AH, we can represent this on this double well diagram here, where the delta H is the enthalpy difference between converting boron from threefold to fourfold coordination or forming a non-bridging oxygen on silica. And converting boron from threefold to fourfold coordination has a lower enthalpy. So that means this is energetically favored or enthalpically favored. But if the concentration of silica is greater than the concentration of B2O3, then forming non-bridging oxygen becomes entropically favored. And then based on changing the fictive temperature of the glass, you can shift this balance between entropy and energy. If you've got a higher fictive temperature, that will favor more non-bridging oxygen formation and therefore a greater fraction of boron in a threefold coordination. However, if you cool slowly and have a lower fictive temperature, that will favor energy or enthalpy compared to entropy, which means that the lower fictive temperature glass, the more slowly cooled glass, has a greater concentration of fourfold coordinated boron and therefore fewer non-bridging oxygens. This shows that you can also convert boron from threefold to fourfold coordination under pressure. So this isn't just a chemistry and a thermal history effect, but if you pressurize the glass, you can convert the local structure of the borate or borosilicate glass from a more open structure that has more threefold coordinated boron to a more compact structure that has more fourfold coordinated boron. This shows as a function of applied pressure that the N4, the fraction of fourfold coordinated boron, is increasing in these borate glasses. And this is also helpful from a very practical point of view. This shows some of the mechanical performance of Corning Gorilla Glass 3 on the right, where this glass was designed to have the modifiers associate just with alumina to allow for fast ion exchange kinetics and to allow for the boron to be in the more open three-fold coordinated structure. The more open structure allows for faster ion exchange kinetics. It also allows for a greater amount of densification underneath an indenter or underneath a scratch. And therefore, having a glass with a higher three-fold coordinated boron gives higher damage resistance, because if you were to subject this glass to an indentation, in a normal glass that doesn't have this effect, once you get beyond the elastic limit, the glass needs to release that energy somehow. And the way that it would release the energy is by forming a crack, because the crack is forming two new surfaces, and those two new surfaces are dissipating the energy. Cracks not only look bad, they compromise the strength of glass. This can occur underneath an indenter, or it can occur under a scratch, as shown here. Now, with a proper design or like an engineering of the glass structure at the atomic level, we can introduce a more kind of a healthier way for the glass to dissipate that energy without forming cracks. And this is what Corning commercialized as native damage resistance. We also call that intrinsic damage resistance. And what it does is it introduces a plastic mode of deformation such that under an indenter or under a scratch, that once you get beyond the elastic limit, the glass can undergo dynamic conversion from threefold to fourfold coordinated boron. This enables a more compact glass structure, so the glass can plastically densify by locally increasing its density and filling in some of those open spaces in the borosilicate glass structure and dynamically converting from threefold to fourfold coordinated boron under pressure. When this happens, this glass can withstand about three times as much force before a crack pops in because of this plastic deformation mode that got introduced. Now, our glass grade for today is Philip Bray. Phil Bray was one of the pioneers of glass structure using NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance. He was born in 1926, got his bachelor's degree in physics at Brown University in 1948, and his PhD in physics at Harvard in 1952. He joined the faculty at Brown in 1955 and spent his 35 career there, and he focused on understanding glass structure using NMR. He studied all kinds of different glass structures. His work on Bore glasses was very influential and really established the NMR method for quantifying the fraction of tetrahedral boron. Phil Bray really paved the way for our understanding of the boron anomaly, and understanding that there are two different structural roles that the modifier can play in borate glasses, so, and in borosilicate glasses. So it's thanks to him that we understand that. So to summarize today's lecture, B2O3 glass consists of BO3 triangular units, the majority of which are grouped into these three-membered boroxyl rings. When modifiers are added to B2O3, we have a boron anomaly, where first boron is converted from trigonal to tetrahedral coordination. Then once we've saturated the amount of tetrahedral boron, there's a conversion of bridging oxygens to non-bridging oxygens, and that occurs on the trigonal units. In borosilicate and aluminosilicate glasses, there are multiple network formers, and therefore the modifiers can play different structural roles. The roles that they play are governed by a trade-off of entropic effects, governed by the concentrations of units, and energetic or enthalpic effects, governed by bonding energies. All right, that does it for borate and borosilicate glass structures. If you have any questions, please let me know. Next time, we're going to deal with some other oxide glass structures like phosphate glasses, germanate glasses, vanadate glasses. So please be sure to come back and join me next time. All right, thank you, everyone.